Good morning. Oh, welcome everybody to Grace Community Church this morning. A special welcome if you're visiting us this morning, and for those of you who are joining us online. My name's Dan, this is La. We are your hosts this morning. Jess in a minute is going to lead us in worship. Sam is going to bring the notices, and then Phil is going to bring God's word to us this morning. But God is here amongst his people, and he is worthy of praise and glory and honour. And Lara is just going to lead us before we worship.
Hello, and a special welcome to Dan's mum, who's tuning in today as well. Good morning. So I woke up at 5 a.m. today. I was really looking forward to sleeping. Did you as well? Oh, it was so annoying. But Alex said to me earlier on in the week, if you wake up early, it might be God telling you to pray. And I went, are you sure I can't pray at around 9? But no. So he said to me, taste and see that the Lord is good. So that's what I'm going to read to you today. Psalm 34. And a band called Sean and Sean, or Shane and Shane, have taken the lyrics straight from the verse. I'm going to read the lyrics. I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on him are radiant. They'll never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds his saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them. Magnify the Lord with me. Come and exalt his name together. Glorify the Lord with me. Come exalt his name forever. And that's what we're going to do today. Come and exalt the Lord with me. We're going to exalt his name forever. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, bless us here who hide in him. All who fear the Lord, oh, all you saints, he will give you everything, everything you need. Magnify the Lord with me. Come and exalt his name together. Glorify the Lord with me. Glorify the Lord with me this morning. Come and exalt his name forever. Let us bless the Lord every day and night. Never-ending praise. May our incense rise to him. And then I put into Google, what does that mean? What does it mean to taste and see that the Lord is good? And it says, how do we taste and see that the Lord is good? By means of trusting in him and doing his will despite whatever. Despite difficulties, despite our mood, despite how we feel, despite what's going on. We will taste and see that he is good. We will be faithful. Amen. Let's stand up this morning and come and worship God with me. Come and exalt him with me.
Give him all the glory, because he deserves that. Great things he has done.
Glory, great things he has done. So love be the word that he gave.
yield to the Father for Jesus the Son.
Let's give Him.
Give Him the glory, great things He has done. Oh yeah.
Yeah, just worship Him right now. I just feel that He just needs to hear you. Give Him all the glory. Give Him all the glory and the praise, because He has done great things in our lives. Yes, Lord, I give You the glory. I give You all the praise. And I come to You this morning, Father, through Jesus the Son. And we give You all the glory. We give You all the glory. All the glory.
Let's lift our voices, everyone. Come on, we're going to praise God together. We're going to lift Him up. We're going to praise Him. Jesus, we come to You today. Jesus, we come to You today, knowing You are good. You, Jesus, going to come to Jesus. Going to taste and see that You are good.
Thank you.
praise. Oh, the glory. Oh, the praise. Oh, the praise, Lord. Thank you.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountains I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Through the darkness, your loving kindness, all through the shadows.
Jesus is our living hope, our amazing Saviour. When he went into the temple, he took a scroll and he read from Isaiah. And he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Jesus is the living hope to the prisoner. He is the living hope to the poor. He is the living hope to those who are sick. He is the living hope to those who are dying. He is the living hope to everyone who puts their faith and trust in him. He is the light in the darkness, and the darkness cannot stand against him. He is our amazing Saviour and worthy of all glory, honour and praise. Forever and ever. Amen.
A thousand generations falling down to worship, to sing a song of ages to live. All who've come before us and all who will believe will sing a song of ages to love.
We're going to sing that verse again. A thousand generations.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing a song of ages to the living. All who've come before us and all who will believe will sing a song of ages to the Lamb.
Cause
your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above it all.
All frogs
to me.
people, declare his holiness in this place. Just sing holy, holy, holy to the Lord in whatever language you want to sing. Holy Lord, holy, holy, holy Lord, you are holy, you are holy, you are holy. Yes, just lift your voice in whatever praise you want to give to him right now. Just declare his goodness, declare his holiness in this place. He is worthy of praise, he is worthy of honor. You will always be, Lord. Nothing in you ever changes, Lord. You were the same yesterday, you're going to be the same today, and you will always be the same forever. Holy then, holy now, holy tomorrow, holy for eternity. And Lord, we want to be like you. We want to be close to you. We want to please you. We want to please you. We want to honor you. We want to lift you up. You are worthy, Lord.
Of praise, in the midst of declaring to the Ancient of Days that you are holy, in the midst of reflecting, as I was just on, like how God spans all time and history and his plans and purposes stand, I think God would say to us, now is your time. You, as he said to Esther, a really key time in the history of God's people, you were standing in front of kings, but he said, you were born for such a time as this. We, each of us, were born for such a time as this. And we are to pick up that baton, as it were, from previous generations. And we will hand it on to future generations. But each of us was born for such a time as this. God would say to us, in the midst of declaring the Ancient of Days, now is our time. Whatever that means in terms of standing firm, whatever that means in terms of taking ground, and whatever that means in terms of advancing the kingdom, now is our time, people. We were born for such a time as this. God has placed us in this moment, in this time, with the people that we know. We were born for such a time as this.
I want to add to that. I have a real sense of God's pleasure this morning when he looks at you. So I'm going to bring you Psalm 147, 10 and 11. His pleasure is not in the strength of horses, nor his delight in the legs of the warrior. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. Hello, family. God says, hello, my children. You are my pleasure, my great pleasure. I have invested heaven in you. Mark has just said, now is the time. God has raised you up to be wherever you are right now. And some of you have already discounted yourselves and said, oh, that's not for me. You've already stopped listening. Give your ears back here. God has chosen you. He has loved you. You are God's pleasure. You are God's delight. You are wonderful to God because he has spent heaven's riches on you. He is pleased to see you. It doesn't matter what your kids behave like. It doesn't matter what kind of shoes you wear or where you come from. God is pleased with you because he knows where you are going. And we all belong together because we are family. So I just want you to know, God wants you to know that he is pleased with you. Amen. Know his heart for you. Know his love for you. Be encouraged this morning. Enjoy singing to him. We can praise Jesus together as a family.
Band, are you all right to keep playing? Let all that I am praise the Lord. This is a prayer for us. Let all that I am praise the Lord with my whole heart, and I will praise his holy name. Let's lift our hands up. I will praise his holy name with my whole heart. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things that he has done for me. He forgives all my sins, and he heals my body, and he redeems me from death, and crowns me with love, and gives me tender mercies, and gives me grace, and he fills my life with good things, and my youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord is compassionate, and he is merciful, and he is slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love for me. He will not constantly accuse us, nor will remain angry forever. And he does not punish us as he should because of his grace for us. For he has removed our sins as far away from us. As far away from us is the east is from the west. He has cast our sins away from us because of his grace, because of his mercy. He is tender and compassionate to those who fear him, for he knows how we were made, and he remembers that we were only dust, and he loves us, and he has removed our sins from us so that we could be with him, so that we would connect with him. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Let's join in with that line. Let all that I am praise the Lord. And again. Let all that I am praise the Lord. And again. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Let's lift our hands. Let all that I am praise the Lord.
Proclaim that forever he will be.
Such a sense of God's presence here this morning with us. Praise Him. All glory belongs to Him. We're going to move on, but before we do, Tony has a testimony he wants to share.
Well, is that on? Those of you who know me will know I'm self-employed, so part of my job is getting laid off and then finding more. And I think God's helped increase my faith in His ability to provide. And sometime last year, I prayed. I prayed for God to give me some work. Work had finished, and I was thinking I'm going to lose a day and just get a four-day week. And on the Sunday, I got a call, which doesn't really happen in the building trade. You've got some work for you tomorrow morning. That was Monday. I thought, oh, yes, excellent. So God provided there. And then a couple of weeks ago, obviously finished for Christmas and New Year, and I was probably a week later into work than I would have liked, and we sort of prayed and we asked God to do something. And it's 2 minutes past seven on the Monday morning. Can you start on site today? Oh, yes. So God provided there and then. And what we prayed was, I want a nice atmosphere on the site. I want somewhere a little bit closer than the 52 miles I've been going each way when we had those cold temperatures on the motorbike. And God did that, and we also asked for a decent rate of pay. So it came, it was a little bit less than I wanted it to be, but it was a lovely atmosphere on site. It was in London, but it's easy to get to, sort of 24 miles, so you know, it's nothing in my business. And a week into the job, we were told that the company that the agency had contracted me to work for was pulling out, and then the guys, the company running the job, said, we're going to take you on direct. Not only did that give me more than the 3 or 4 weeks potentially than we were promised, it looks like it's going to lead up to the job that I'm waiting for. And they gave us an extra hour a day, and they gave us £1 an hour raise as well. So you know, God did the third thing. And if that ain't enough, on Friday, my bike suddenly got a lot louder. Now, anyone that knows me knows that I like loud bikes, but this wasn't a good loud, you know. And so I had a look, and it looked like an exhaust stud had broken, that holds the top of the pipe to the engine. And, oh, no, you know, this could cost a few hundred quid. And I was going in to get my brake pads replaced, and he had a look, and he said, actually, this one, they're holding it in with bolts, so nothing had broken off inside, the bolt had just vibrated loose and come out. So he said, I'm not charging anything, it took about 5 seconds to do. I've got a bolt out the back, I've slapped it in, tightened it up, all's good. And then this morning, which I didn't realise I was going to say this, Wendy and I were praying, and we prayed for family and this, that and the other, and also prayed that God would do something this morning that would pour out His Holy Spirit. And then this stuff happened this morning. I think we can say that, you know, the Holy Spirit's done something a bit special. And that was another answer to prayer. And I think at the end of the day, you need to pray for these things that you're asking God for. You know, don't think it's too much for God to ask. You know, don't think you don't deserve it. You just ask in faith that you're going to receive, then thank God for it. And, you know, proves He's faithful. So there you go.
Thanks, Tony. I just want to honour Tony because he is a man of faith. Yeah, he trusts God completely to provide his work and his job situation, and God always comes through for him. And he often comes on the men's group asking for prayer, asking for the men to pray when he needs work. And it's just a fantastic example of a guy who's trusting God and walking with God. So thank you, Tony. Right, we're going to move on. Sam's got the notices.
God is good, isn't he? That's really encouraging. Good morning. Okay, I've got a few notices for you. First thing, just a little bit of family news. Mo Whitehorn, for those of you that know Mo, you know, she might have, she was in the hospital recently because of her hip. She's now out of the hospital and back into her care home. So that's good. Thank you, those of you who have been praying. Continue to pray for Mo and her recovery from that. So that would be excellent. Thank you. I've got a letter from Food Shed. So Food Shed is the sort of food bank type thing run by Vineyard in Stevenage. Just thanking Grace Community Church for continuing to give to and donate to the Food Shed. I just wanted to, the main message is to pass on thanks to you all for your generosity, both financially and in terms of food that would have gone in the thing out of there. There are some statistics in this letter as well, which are worth hearing, particularly around Christmas. So it says here, Christmas, they were able to give away bags of presents to over 360 children. Who otherwise may have had nothing on Christmas Day. They're really grateful for that, and the people who, and the parents particularly, who received those things, really grateful. At their last drop-in session before Christmas, they saw 139 clients and gave away around 650 bags of food, including 140 bags of fresh fruit and vegetables, that's harder to say than I thought, and 140 Christmas meal bags. So there's two things going on here, right? It's really great to be able to give to this thing, and I want to encourage you in your generosity, but also there's a real need. It kind of highlights the need that's going on in the town. So if you are able to give to that thing, then to the Food Shed, then please continue to do that. There continues to be a need. There is always a basket in the foyer out there that Roger collects from and takes to the food bank, to the Food Shed. If you are able to give and continue to be generous, please do. It's a really good thing, and it's really helping people. And pray for the Food Shed as well, and for the people that they serve. Also really important. Okay, this Wednesday is session 3 of the Romans course. If you've joined us for the first two sessions that were in January, you will know it's been a really good thing. It's been really helpful and interesting. It's not too late, if you haven't been to the first two, to join in. Do come along on Wednesday night at 8 p.m. All of you are welcome. It's a really interesting time. We'll sit on some tables in here and have some discussions. It's very friendly and relaxed, nothing weird. There's a really interesting and well-made video to watch talking about the Book of Romans. I found it really helpful. So come along if you're able to, even if you haven't been able to thus far. That's this Wednesday. At 8 p.m. I'm going to be here. It's my birthday on Wednesday, and I will be here anyway. So, you know, if I can be here, so can you. I really wasn't looking for that. Thank you. Okay, Dad, you've got a notice. Oh, and yes, if you can't be here on Wednesday, which we understand that there might be lots of reasons that you couldn't be here on Wednesday, then we'd also run the same session on Zoom. Jessica sort of hosts it at the same time on Wednesday night, and there'll be a link in an email. It's the same link as you got 2 weeks ago, in case you're wondering, but we'll send it out again probably. Right, over to you.
Brilliant, thank you. So those of you that know your church calendar, will know that on Wednesday we are entering the season of Lent. That is the 40 days that runs up to Easter. If you're anything like me, actually most of you, that will have probably passed you by and you won't have realised. But let me tell you, Wednesday is Lent. And following on the success of having a devotional book for Advent, the run-up to Christmas, we have joined together with our friends from St. Nicholas and Longmeadow churches to get hold of a devotional book for Lent. It's 40 readings in the Book of Lamentations. It's called Finding Mercy on the Way of Sorrow. I've had a quick flick through it. I think it's excellent, actually. To state what is probably obvious to most people who've been a Christian for any length of time, following Jesus is not always a problem-free life. And Jesus never promised that it would be. But actually, the normal Christian life is for there to be suffering and for there to be difficulties and for there to be hardships. That's just a normal part of following Jesus. And many in this church right now will know that to be true. There are many in this church right now who are going through difficulties of various kinds. The Book of Lamentations is really, it's a gift from God to his people to help us to process suffering, to help us come face to face with the seriousness of sin, and to help us find genuine hope in God. Just picking up on what Mark said, actually, we're going to be a people who kind of take our place in God's purposes in our generation. We're going to need to be a people who learn how to walk through suffering and difficulty and to do it well. We're going to need to learn how to do that so that we're able to stand our ground and not fall away when difficult things happen. I really believe this book will help us to do that. So I'd like to really recommend it strongly to you. We have 33 copies at the cost of £1 each. I'm going to put them on a table out in the foyer so that when you leave the building this morning, you'll have a chance to grab one. They're £1 each. If you can't afford £1, I would rather you had a book than paid £1 for it. If you can afford to pay more for £1, why don't you put more in and pay for somebody else who can't afford to have one? There's 33. When they're gone, they're gone. Actually, the bookseller who's doing this deal has sold out of them. We can't get any more. So grab one and use it. Starting Wednesday, 40 readings. If you do 6 a week, it'll take you up to Easter. You get Sunday off. Go for it.
Thank you. Start a bun fight on the way out of the building, but hopefully it'll be all right. We're all nice to each other. Okay, just final things then. This morning's special offering is for Zakia Moyo and the churches he leads in Zimbabwe, as well as the offering that we take up every week that supports everything that goes on here in the church and its various outreaches to the community, etc., etc. There are pots at the back if you've got cash. There is a card reader at the back if you've got a card. There are forms at the back if you wanted to give by standing order or something like that. There's all sorts of ways you can give, but you are not obliged to give if you're visiting with us this morning. We're just really pleased that you're here. Please don't feel you have to take part in that. But those are the options if you want to. And in a moment, the children are going to go out. So if you are sort of primary school aged, you know, go out and turn and follow round to the various jam groups. Gig are also out this morning, so that's secondary school aged. You're also going out that way towards the community hall. If you're not sure where you're going, just ask somebody friendly for directions, and you'll make it there. And then Phil is going to come and speak to us.
wonders never cease. Not even life, not even death, nor any power in heaven or earth could separate us from your love, for you are good, and your mercies last a lifetime. You are good, always, always, every day. Your love is never ending, for you are good, always, always. Freely you gave.
Okay, it's good to see everyone. Good morning, everyone. Let's pray, can we? Father, we just want to say thank you again for the time that we've had in your presence. Lord, we love you and we love to meet with you, and we love it when you are with us in that way by your Spirit. And we also love your word and the work you're doing among us. And Father, we pray this morning that your word will come and will speak to our hearts and will accomplish all that you intend this morning. In Jesus' name, Lord, help us by your Spirit to hear you. Help us by your Spirit to put into practice whatever you might say. Amen. Okay, so 2 weeks ago, John started us off on what we're calling the Culture Reboot series. And it's being rebooted because... This is something we started working on before COVID and before lockdown and all those kind of things. And then that came and interrupted. And so we're kind of doing a refresh or a reboot on the issue of culture. And if you remember back 2 weeks ago, John defined culture as being the attitudes and the behaviors and the ideas, values, customs of any particular group of people. Because every group of people, any kind of group of people that you can think of, will have its own culture. Offices, factories, building sites. We heard Tony talking about the culture of, he wanted a nice culture. That's, he didn't use that word, but it's what he meant, didn't he? He wanted a happy atmosphere, a nice culture on the building site there. And so, and that applies also to churches. We need to have the right kind of culture if we are to be what God wants us to be and to accomplish all that God wants us to accomplish. It's an important element in the way in which God may be able to use us. Peter Drucker, some people might have heard of. He's a well-known business consultant and author, and he famously said this. He said, "Culture eats strategy for breakfast," which I think is a great, great quote. And what he means really, I think, is that organizations can have their plans, but how effective those plans will be will to a very large extent depend on the culture of the organisation itself. It will affect how people engage with those plans and all kinds of things like that. And so it's really important for us that we have a godly culture. Really important. If our plans, how the works out, will be to a large extent determined by the culture that we have among us. And to put that in negative terms, if for example, we had a culture of grumbling and moaning and selfishness and disunity, I think we can all see that would be a bit of a hindrance to what God might want to do with us. We need to be different from that. And we spent a lot of time thinking about this, and when we first started thinking about it, I was the one, unfortunately, who said, well, surely all we need is a culture of faith and love, and isn't that basic to any church? And then wiser people than me said, but what does that actually look like? And more precisely, what does it look like for us in terms of who God has made us to be and what he's called us to be? And so in answer to those questions, after lots of talking and praying and consulting with one another, we came down to this, that we want to have a culture of compassion and honour and authenticity and generosity and adventure. That sound good to anybody? It sounds good to me. And in case you're wondering, well, how will that happen? How can that possibly be? It's very simple. It's very simple. It's by the working of God's Spirit through the preaching of God's word and the response of God's people. That's easy, isn't it? What could be difficult about that? That's how it will happen. And so, so far what we've had is, 2 weeks ago, John gave us an excellent general introduction to the subject and looked at each one of those values in turn. And then last week, Dan spoke really well about honour, what it means to honour people, to treat people as though, as they are, made in the image of God. And I don't know how that was for you, but I found both of those talks really encouraging, really inspiring, challenging. And I came away with a sense of God is actually on this. This is something which is really on his agenda for us. So this week I am talking about compassion. There we are. Never mind. I haven't yet learned to press the buttons properly. So anyway, compassion. Compassion is to be concerned for the suffering of others. So literally in English, the word means to suffer with. And in the New Testament, the word in the original language in the Greek there means to be moved inwardly. It is a gut reaction, a gut reaction. And if you think about it, obviously compassion really is an expression of the love for people that Jesus says we are to have. He says second most important thing you can do is to love your neighbours as yourself. In the Gospels, Jesus himself is often described as having compassion, of being moved with compassion for needy people of all kinds, for the lost, for the hungry, for the sick, for the poor. And his compassion always leads to some form of action, teaching, feeding, healing, forgiving, and so on. So his example shows us that compassion is a heart attitude that leads to action for the benefit of those in need. And so what do you think? What would a culture of compassion look like? Just think about this for a minute. What would it look like in this church to have a culture of compassion? Just think. Anybody want to volunteer something? Sam has become Mr. Roving Mike. Let me just ask sort of three or four people maybe to just volunteer. Oh, right at the back there, Alex is already waving his arms around. He's got an idea. That's good.
Considering others.
Yeah, cool. Thank you. Considering others, that's good. Anybody else want to? John, thank you.
Just being close and alongside others who are going through really hard times.
Yeah, that's good. Excellent. Anybody else? Oh, Tony.
An example might be if you see somebody homeless sitting on the side, and I've been homeless on a couple of occasions, so I know, you know, I've not been on the streets, but it's hard. They don't deserve it. But just having that compassion for them, just, you know, meeting their need, that might be a bit of food or a hot drink on a cold day, that sort of thing, and just blessing them, you know.
Thank you. Thank you, Tony. Anyone else?
It's like when you feel motivated enough to ease someone from what they're feeling or relieve them from the suffering that they're going through.
Yeah, thank you. That's good. Okay. Thanks, Sam. That's good. Yeah, those are all really good. I've got things like this. Being kind-hearted and understanding towards others in their weakness. Welcoming needy people among us, being concerned for their welfare. Having caring hearts of people who are suffering and disadvantaged and responding practically. Being ready to minister to the needs of people in the wider world beyond this church. Tony was saying that about homeless people. It's really good. And here's a good one. Understanding that the resources that God has given us aren't just for our own benefit. He gives them to us that we might share them with other people. And also properly valuing our community ministries, our Grace's Space and Journey Place, Clothing Bank and so on, and not just seeing them as kind of add-ons that are just optional. They're important. They're good ways of showing compassion. And I'm sure that you could think of other examples if we sat here long enough. I mean, that the list of possibilities is as long as the list of neediness in the world, isn't it? There are multitudes of ways. And so in terms of preaching this morning, I'm kind of spoiled for choice for picking a passage. There's just so much of it. There's so many examples in the life of Jesus and in his teaching, in the story, for example, of the Good Samaritan, which ends with that great punchline, "Now you go and do the same." That's brilliant. Would have been good to preach about that. Or maybe to think about the prodigal son and the compassion that his father had for that son. It's another great example there. Or I could talk about those occasions in the Old Testament where God himself is described as compassionate. Maybe that time when he revealed himself to Moses saying, the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion and sin. Now God himself is a compassionate God. This is where it's all coming from. Or maybe in the New Testament, I could have spoken about that verse in James where he says, religion that our God and Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress. So really, it's lots of choice. And I'd like to preach all those verses, but not this morning. But what happened is that really quite early in December, a passage of Scripture came to me, and I don't know how to describe it. It kind of pressed itself in on me and started to live with me really quite strongly. And it came with a sense that what the Father wants for us is that we should be much more radical in the area of compassion in both terms of our understanding and practice. He wants us to be a radically compassionate people. So I'm believing that passage is the one that he wants to speak to us from. It's a great passage because it really does hit a number of nails very squarely and fairly on the head. And in this particular passage, I'm going to focus mainly on just two words out of it. And one of those words is mercy, but you'll understand that mercy is a kind of synonym. It means much the same as compassion. And that's how I'm going to deal with it. So we are in the Old Testament, and we are in Micah, the prophet Micah, and we're at chapter 6. And Micah was a prophet who ministered around the same time as Isaiah, so late 8th, early 7th century BC, and he addressed some of the same kinds of issues. And chapter 6 begins with him calling the people to account for their sin. Speaking through the prophet, God is challenging his people. And he asks them, well, how have I wronged you that you should behave like this? And he reminds them that he delivered them from slavery in Egypt, provided leaders for them, met their needs, defended them against their enemies. In other words, God had dealt with his people with an abundance of grace and mercy, but they just were not responding to him in the way that he had wanted them to. And then from verse 6, following that challenge, there's an imagined question from a representative of the people who expresses the attitude of the time. And this is what he says. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? And then the prophet responds on behalf of the Lord. He's shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. So this person, the representative worshipper, was apparently very ignorant of what God required of him, yet shouldn't have been. It's very clearly spelled out in God's laws for him and had been reinforced in all kinds of ways ever since. But this person imagined that somehow or other God would be satisfied, bought off, fobbed off even, by religious observances without living an obedient life. And in fact, when you see it, what he suggests is ridiculous, and it gets more extreme as he goes on. So should he sacrifice some calves? How about thousands of rams? I mean, just picture that for a minute. Thousands of rams. 10,000 rivers of olive oil. Imagine the Thames. Fill it up with olive oil. Multiply that by 10,000. Would God like that? Will that keep God happy? Or really shockingly, how about my own child? Would God be very happy if I sacrificed to him my own child? And the question is, you know, how religious do you want me to be? Keep complaining about what I'm doing. How religious do you want me? Will you be satisfied with all this extreme religiosity? And this person has not understood who God is. He's not understood what it is that God wants. See, you cannot buy God off with religion. You cannot buy God off with religion, however extreme. And you might think, well, that's a bit obvious, isn't it? That person was kind of daft, and he was meant to be. The prophet was exaggerating to make a point. The ritual aspects of God's covenant had their place, but obedience to the moral requirements of God's law was far more important, and that was what God wanted for them. Not loads of ritual, but obedience. No amount of religiosity can substitute for a life of obedience. And you might think that's daft. But here's the thing. We are not entirely immune from thinking in that way. We're not immune from thinking that God will be satisfied with our religious observances, regardless of how we live. And unfortunately, there are things around in the church at large which make us a bit vulnerable to that way of thinking. So when I first became a Christian, which back with the dinosaurs all those years ago, there was some standard advice to give to new Christians, and it went like this. You know, you say, well, what do I do now? And they would say, well, read your Bible, pray, be a witness, and join a church. Did anybody else ever receive advice like that? Yeah, I'm guessing we did. And so the danger is that we can think to ourselves like this. Well, I read the Bible a bit. I try and pray. I feel guilty about witnessing and I go to church. Ta-da, the Christian life. God's happy. Except maybe he isn't. Maybe that's not really quite what he's looking for. It would have been much better if the advice the new Christians from the very beginning said, your job now is to follow Jesus. And what that looks like is that you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, and your neighbor as yourself. This is what you are meant to be doing. And by the way, reading your Bible and praying and being a part of a church family, that will put fuel on your fire. It will give you a context for working things out. That will be much better to put it that way. See, we need to understand that God is not religious. And he hates empty religion. He's not interested in spiritual practices which are not accompanied by obedience. Spiritual practices with obedience, good. Spiritual practices without obedience, bad. It's not what he's about. And Isaiah is particularly sharp on this. In Isaiah chapter 1, there's a rant in which God says to his people, I am fed up with your sacrifices. I hate your festivals with all my being. I'm weary of it. And I'm not even listening to your prayers. I think there was a great sermon to be had there, isn't there, someday? Does God hate your devotions? It's a really important question. Isaiah, like Micah, says that what the Lord really wants is obedience, and obedience of a particular kind. He says this, learn to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow. Or in other words, love your neighbor as yourself and stand up for people who are being made to suffer. So to be clear, you'll understand, I'm not saying don't read your Bible and all those other things. Do all of those things. But the New Testament says don't just be a hearer of the word, be a doer of the word as well. So God's very clear. He doesn't want empty religion. And he's equally clear about what it was that he does want. And what he wants is not horrible. He says it's good. In our reading, verse 8, he said, he's shown you, O mortal, what is good. See, God thinks this is good. What he requires of us in his eyes, it's good. When he sees us behaving these ways, he gives him pleasure. He looks at that and says, I really like that. I'm blessed by seeing people live like that. And if we appreciate things, as we begin to appreciate things, as he appreciates things, we will understand ourselves that, hey, this is really good. This is better than anything that happens in the world. But it is a requirement. Again, he asks, what does the Lord require of you? So what's a requirement? Anyone want to tell me what a requirement is?
Something you have to do.
Something you have to do, yes. Something you have to do. So it's not a suggestion. It's not even something we ought to do or are supposed to do. I'm supposed to put out the recycling every 2 weeks. I won't get into trouble if I don't. I just spend 2 weeks wondering what to do with all the plastic and the cardboard, but nobody else is bothered. I ought probably to go on a diet. Those things are optional, but I am required by something to do something. I'm required to pay my taxes. I'm required to stick to the speed limit. Those things are not optional. So this is something that God requires of us. But to be clear, it's not about earning God's favor. It's not about winning salvation. We're saved by Jesus, by faith in him. But if we've been saved by grace, then out of gratitude, we are obedient. And the Lord's requirements for us come down to, in Micah, three easily remembered things that are really just different ways of saying that we're to love God and love people. So he says we're to... Yeah, I can't see that. Ah, yes, we're to act... sorry, we're to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. To act justly means to just simply treat everybody right. It's very simple. If you're somebody with authority, then you must be scrupulous in the way that you exercise it, not for your own advantage or for some kind of power trip. For the rest of us, treat people well, treat them with respect. Don't use, abuse, exploit, manipulate, or deceive people, or take them for granted. Be grateful, be thankful, pay your bills on time. And to walk humbly with your God. The Bible uses walking as a picture of the way that we live. So to walk humbly with our God then is to be mindful of our relationship with him, of who he is, living respectfully, not carelessly before him. He is the Lord God Almighty. He's not Santa Claus. So these are God's good requirements, but what stood out to me, it's the middle one, the second one, that I really felt that he wants to draw our attention to this morning. And it's not more important than the other two. It's just, I think, where he's shining a light for us at the moment. It's the requirement of us that we should love mercy. We're to love mercy. We're to love compassion. It's a curious phrase, isn't it? Don't you think? To love mercy. When I read that, I thought, well, I wonder what that means. Particularly, what does it mean to love? What does that word love mean? What really does that word? So I have all sorts of clever things on my computer, and I looked up the meaning of the word love in the original Hebrew. And you'll never guess what it actually means. It actually means you're meant to love. It means love. You're meant to love mercy. We're meant to love compassion. Really, our Father in heaven requires of us that we should be people who love mercy, who love kindness, who love compassion, who love doing all the things that we spoke about a few minutes ago. Not just do them, that's good, not just do them, but love doing them. To help you land this, let me tell you about the scale of compassion. Has anybody heard of a scale of compassion? No, there's a reason for that. It's that I just invented it. Okay, but so the scale of compassion goes a bit like this. So at the bottom of the scale, there are people who are actively hateful. These are people they abuse, they exploit, they oppress, and so on, all to their own advantage. Is this what the Lord requires of us? No. Right answer. Obviously not. And then moving up the scale, there are people who are not so actively hateful, but they're simply indifferent. These are people, they see suffering around them, they see needy people around them, and they say, tough, hard luck, it's hard life. As long as I'm okay and my family's okay, well, that's all that matters. Is this what the Lord requires of us? No. And then as we come further up the scale, there are people who see suffering and neediness and so forth, and it kind of touches them. It kind of touches them. They have an opinion about it, and they like to express their opinions whenever they have a chance. And maybe they feel good about themselves, about having these opinions, and even superior to people who don't have those opinions. There's a problem, though. They don't actually do anything. They just have the opinions. So is this what the Lord requires of us? No, it's not. And then there's another step along the way. We're getting a little bit nearer. There are people who see suffering and neediness, and they might actually do something about it. But their first reaction really is one of caution. They see the need and they think, well, maybe I should do something about it. But immediately, caution kicks in. And so they're asking all kinds of things like, well, is this really a deserving person? Do I have the resources? Do I have the ability to meet this person's needs? What if I get in over my head? Supposing I get ripped off. And actually, let me just tell you an aside. If you decide to practice compassion, at some point, you will get ripped off. Just goes with the territory. It's kind of fine. Anyway, so this person might actually do something. They might well show kindness and compassion and mercy, but they'll do it with a degree of reluctance and maybe even fearfulness. So is this what the Lord requires of us? Not quite. No, it isn't. We're not quite there yet. It's an improvement, but we're not quite there yet. And then finally, there are enthusiasts, people who love to show mercy, who love to show compassion and kindness. Is this what the Lord requires of us? Yes, it's what it says, isn't it? This is what the Lord requires of us, that we should love mercy, that we should love compassion, we should love to practice kindness. We should be passionate about it. We should be enthusiastic for it, that we should be excited about it, that we should find joy in it. Because that's what it's like to love something, isn't it? We give ourselves to it. We're keen on it. Sometimes you see people get very enthusiastic about football, of all things. And people love football, that's fine. But you see people, and they spend loads of money travelling up and down the country, and they buy a bobble hat. And do they still have those rattle things? No, they don't. Okay, but they squeeze into a shirt with their favourite player's name on the back that fits nicely over their beer bump. And they're passionate about football. They love football. God wants us to love mercy. He wants us to be excited by it. He wants us to give ourselves to it, to expend ourselves on it. That's what it means, isn't it? To love mercy. To love mercy. Because bottom line is, we're meant to love people with passion. So for me, I don't know about you, but for me, that's a bit of a challenge, isn't it? And if it's not a challenge, I probably haven't said it right. But it is a challenge that goes straight to our hearts, because that's the significance, isn't it, of the word love in this sentence. Because love is it's a thing in here, isn't it? The Lord doesn't just require of us that we merely do acts of compassion, but that we should love to do acts of compassion. It's a heart issue. It's to do with our affections and our motivations. Jackie Pullinger, English missionary to the slums of Hong Kong, said Christians are meant to have soft hearts and hard feet, but unfortunately too often they have hard hearts and soft feet. And so with this challenge and this little phrase, love mercy, the Lord is aiming an arrow right at our hearts, right at the center of our being. He's not merely calling for a change in behavior, he's calling for a change of heart, a change of attitude, a change of motivation, because the reality is, without that, it doesn't last. You might have a little burst of enthusiasm, but it won't continue. It starts, as everything in the Christian life, it starts in our hearts. And it's great, because changed hearts is what God is all about, isn't it? It's the new covenant. I'll take away your heart of stone. I'll give you a heart of flesh. It's an ongoing process. And the way, whenever there's this kind of a challenge to our hearts, we respond with faith, we respond with repentance, we respond with prayer, and we pray it through until we get there. And it's a process, an ongoing process. God wants us to have changed hearts this morning, which love mercy, which are passionate about compassion, which are keen on kindness. Little while ago, I was feeling a bit challenged about this issue myself, and I could see that I was doing some things that were along these lines, but I thought to myself, I don't seem to be doing very much. And so I began to pray about it. And it turns out that this is the kind of prayer that God likes to answer. Because since then, Madeline and I together have had all kinds of opportunities to show compassion to people. And it's been good. But to be honest, I was really actually at that point only thinking having something to do. And it might have been a bit like a box-ticking exercise. But not only did I get some more things to do, I found that in the process, God kind of changed my heart. He shifted the dial, if you like, on compassion. See, God's interested in our hearts. And it's hearts and actions together in that order. So I'm going to come back to this in a minute. This point, we'll end on this point, but I'll go off on a little detour for a moment, because I think it's worth talking about where we're at as a church. How compassionate actually are we as a church? And I think the answer is that we are definitely, very definitely not nowhere. In fact, there's a great deal to be encouraged about, because, you know, he's been working this into us since the very beginning of this church. It even made it into our vision statement to be sharing the love of Jesus in word and action. And we can see compassion very clearly working through our community ministries, through Doorway, Grace's Space, Journey Place, Clothes Bank, and so on. And we see compassion being exercised in our overseas giving. And we saw mercy and kindness and compassion being practiced at Christmas time, didn't we, with the children's disco and the meal for refugees on Boxing Day. And we can see it working out as well, I think, very clearly often in the lives of particular individuals. So back when we had small groups, there was one Wednesday evening, I was sitting in Scott's living room with everybody else, and I looked around and I thought, wow, here is Scott, who at one point used to have his own business, but was now working with needy children who were in danger of suffering in their education. And he was doing that with such a passion. Those of us who remember Scott, he was really into that. And then there was Richard, who changed jobs to go work with the homeless and had taken a pay cut to do that. And we had Flo, who was doing social work to care for elderly people. And there was Roger, who spent his whole life working with people with learning disabilities. And having retired, he'd retrained as a counsellor and was working to support people with addictions. And he was doing all kinds of other things as well. And at the time with us, we had Julie, who was working in a school to support one child with special needs who would not otherwise have got an education. And I looked around and I said to myself, this is actually quite impressive for a small group of people, for as many people as you can fit into a living room. This is pretty good. All these people in different ways sharing the love of Jesus, showing compassion for needy people. And the thing is, they're not the only ones. They are not the only ones. And many people in this church family are showing compassion for needy people. On the front row here, Pat, who is a couple of years past retirement, is volunteering in the hospital. That's a work of compassion, isn't it? So I just think there's such a lot to be encouraged about. You know, the Holy Spirit, the Father in heaven, has worked this in us. He is working it in us. In fact, I think where we've been at fault is in not recognizing it for what it is. We've never celebrated it, have we? We've never said, hey.
Not as we should.
Hmm?
Not as we should.
Not as we should, no. No. But it's good. God's doing a good thing. God has done a good thing. And there's lots and lots to be encouraged about. It is who we are. So let's own that, shall we? Yeah. Let's say God is making us a compassionate people. At the same time, I still have this sense that actually he's not finished, and that what he's looking for is something really very radical, even more so than we are now. Radically compassionate, like Jesus himself, who was, if anybody ever was, radically compassionate. But as coming back to where I left off, it's not in this first instance about adding more ministries or each of us finding a new job or taking up a new activity. Is about our heart. It has to start in the heart with, we're to love mercy. It's to be a motivating passion for us. It starts with our hearts, because when the heart changes, the behavior just follows. So the Father in heaven, who is himself compassionate and gracious and abounding in love and faithfulness, wants us to be that people who love mercy, who are enthusiasts for compassion, passionate about kindness, who live compassionate lifestyles. And he will work this in us by his Spirit if we'll be brave enough to ask him. And he'll give us with that opportunities to practice, because within this congregation right now there are people who are seriously in need of our compassion in all kinds of different ways. So I want to leave you with a couple of questions. We'll take a few moments to consider them.
you might want to ask yourself, am I willing for the Holy Spirit to change my heart, to make me someone who loves mercy, compassion and kindness? Am I brave enough to ask him to do that in me? And then what does he want me to do practically? Let's just take a couple of minutes or moments to think about that, to talk to God about that, and then I'll finish with a prayer. Father God, we want to thank you that you are a God of all compassion, God of kindness, a God of mercy. Lord, we just have to acknowledge that if we're yours this morning, then we are recipients of your compassion, recipients of your mercy. Lord, every day you are kind to us in a multitude of ways. And Father, we thank you that you are asking us to be like you and to be like your Son, who also came and showed compassion in so many ways. Holy Spirit, will you please work this in us? Will you continue to work it in us in the days to come? Lord, let your compassion flood this people. Let your compassion flood our hearts. Lord, let us be known in heaven as a people who are full of compassion. In Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Thank you. We'll have the band back. We'll have one last song.
I see the King of Glory.
Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. That is officially the end of the service.